when I heard about the shooting, okay, I mean, I was shocked because it was something that was so close to home here in Tucson, you know, and I never would have had any idea that Jared was involved. You know, his name did not, you know, pop in my head. But then when I found out who it was, okay, I mean, I was equally shocked. I just couldn't believe that something like that happened and he was involved, and that he had actually been in my house, that I had spoken to him, that he had been friends with my son. So it just really, you know, kind of shocked me. But the reality was, we kind of knew him all too well. And I had to take some time to go back and reflect about all the things that were going on during the time frame, you know, that he was associated with us. And then I started seeing things that started making sense as to, you know, why would he do something so crazy like this? Okay, I mean, the whole thing about the dreaming and the alternate reality, I can see where he can kind of start getting so absorbed into that that he's not actually living in reality anymore. He's like living in a dream. There was a lot of talk about lucid dreaming and understanding reality, the whole thing about dreaming. And there was a lot of books and movies that were brought into play that he introduced, you know, to either my son and then ultimately to the rest of the family. Things that I would have never, you know, even heard about or watched. And things like Loose Change, about the 9/11 conspiracy, that it was a government, you know, false flag operation. He watched things like that. He wanted to be a writer, and that he wrote short stories. And one day when he came over, he had brought a short story with him that he had recently written, and he asked for me to read it. And I read it, and then he wanted to know what my, you know, impression of it was. And I kind of told him that, you know, it was nicely written, but I didn't really understand the message that he was trying to convey in it. You know, I could tell there was a message, but I didn't really understand what it was. And then he kind of responded that he was, you know, a little bit offended that I didn't understand, you know, what he was trying to write about. One of the things, like when I initially met him, is that he had that odd smile that he would give you. And the only thing that I could kind of, you know, relate it to was the Cheshire Cat from Alice in Wonderland. He just had that mischievous looking grin. And I just thought, you know, initially when I met him, that it was a little strange. This type of stuff that he was into and believed, it just kept eating away at him and eating away at him, and he didn't have anybody else to turn to. I mean, he had already, you know, disassociated himself with his whole circle of friends. I don't think that he could really, you know, talk to his parents about it. He had gotten kicked out of school. He had lost his job. From what I heard from my son, I think he worked for Eddie Bauer, is that? And that he got fired from his job. So he had basically nothing going for him. And I think he just couldn't deal with his reality anymore, and that this was his way of lashing out and maybe relieving some of that pain and pressure that had been bothering him for so long. Well, I know that he was experimenting with the drug or herb or whatever it is, Salvia divinorum. And from what I hear, he used it quite frequently, and that it's like a hallucinogenic type of effect, and it can have either short-term or long-term, you know, problems associated with use.